The information contained in this podcast is an expression of opinion and does not constitute investment advice. This is the Gold Money Podcast with Alistair MacLeod, keeping you up to date with expert opinion on precious metals and the markets.
Hello, this is Alistair MacLeod, and with me is Chris Martinson of peakprosperity.com. He needs no introduction at all. I had a very interesting debate or discussion with him in Madrid earlier last year, and it's very nice to have the opportunity to see him again. Welcome, Chris.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be talking with you again.
It's very much my pleasure. Now, you've changed the name of your website and your business since we met last. You've changed it from chrismartinson.com to peakprosperity.com. What was the thinking behind that?
A couple of things were driving that. The first was that by coming to a place called chrismartinson.com, the first-time visitor couldn't orient to that unless they'd been oriented with myself. So we wanted to come up with a name that reflected really what we were about. And in part of that is the idea that I didn't want this to be about me anymore. I wanted to start minimizing my own central role in all of this. You know, people oftentimes get to chapter 20 of the crash course, and they're waiting for me to tell them what to do. And it's very disappointing because I say, here are the tools that you need to figure out how to make your own decisions. And so really, the summary is people were looking for a guru. I've always eschewed that role, thinking, no, this is about individual responsibility. And I want to offer as much context and advice as I can, yet not have it be about me. And by coming to Peak Prosperity, we think that name really captures what we're about. This is a team effort now. We have lots of guest contributors, of which you are one. And we really want to bring in the voices that can coalesce around this idea that even though there are extraordinary changes coming, there's lots we can do about it. We have responsibility to take care of not just our own lives, but other lives around us. You know, this is a great moment in history. So Peak Prosperity was our attempt to capture all of that in a name and move towards a different brand, if you were.
Absolutely. But the name is interesting, too. In Peak Prosperity, it rather suggests that things aren't going to get any better. I do know that you've been on a long personal journey, if I can describe it that way, of trying to understand what had happened. And now you've been, for some years, passing the benefits of that self-education on to other people. The idea of peak prosperity, it does suggest that things are probably going to go downhill in some senses from here. Would I be right in that assumption behind the name?
If we're characterizing prosperity simply around material wealth, that's probably going to be the case for a great majority of the people out there, simply because we've passed a peak in some very important essential items, or we're right at peak. You know, we know that trajectory is going to take us from 7 billion to 9 billion people, barring something rather dramatic happening. This is just the inertia of the population system that we're on. And we know that the amount of soil that we've got, the amount of water that's in aquifers, the amount of oil that we can pump out of the ground, these are all limited as well. So the amount of stuff that we're going to have per person certainly, I think, is at a peak. What's not implied in that peak prosperity is the idea, however, that there isn't a better life, a higher quality of life that's available to us once we start to move away from the idea that all wealth is measured in dollars. There's lots of other wealth that obviously anybody who gets sick understands health is actually very important. There are lots of things out there that we like to put and include in this circle of prosperity, as it were. Security is very high. Being able to live in a safe environment. You and I earlier were talking about some of the trends that had happened where in Kenya they'd gone into a fairly corrupt environment because the money itself had become corrupted, and that leads to a sense of lawlessness. And that's a corrosive effect that we'd love to avoid if we can. So that when I say safety, I mean safety from corruption, from physical safety is obviously important. But really it's the idea that we have opportunities available to us because our society is functioning and functioning well. In order for that to happen, I think we have to have other things in that circle of prosperity. Community is very important to us, both at our where we live, but on the website. A sense of belonging, a sense of having a life where our jobs have purpose. These are all important ideas. So can we be prosperous even though we're at a peak? The answer is yes. That's also what we were trying to capture in that title.
We have to change our values, I think, is part of what you're saying. And I was very struck when you were speaking this morning that you referred back to what your grandfather did and how the habits of previous generations carried on, you know, looking after, harvesting vegetables and things like that, even though he didn't need to because he was wealthy enough to go and buy food and so on. So it was habit. We've lost those habits, was really one of the points you were making. I found that very, very interesting because people presumably are going to have to change their behavior. They're going to have to rethink, particularly because the welfare state, for example, cannot provide. Governments don't have any money. They never do. They have to get that money from someone else. The burden on the state from all our expectations and so on are really too great now. So in the future, I guess that we have to start looking after ourselves, start thinking for ourselves, rather than thinking the state would provide. Would you say that encapsulates your approach?
Absolutely. You know, we do cater to a certain clientele, and it's captured in this idea. Psychologists tell us that there are really only two ways people change, because what you're talking about is that there's a fundamental need to change, maybe change our behaviors, maybe change our priorities, maybe elevate certain values and de-elevate other ones. All of those changes, psychology is very clear on this. People only change through one of two mechanisms. They either change by insight or by pain. Now, the pain channel, we all understand that one. The alcoholic has to hit rock bottom. You know, somebody has to wake up in a gutter. Your marriage has to fall apart before you finally look inward and see what the cause might be. A lot of people are going to experience change by pain. Greece, I think, as a nation, is experiencing change by pain at this point.
Yes, that's true.
What we're trying to cater towards is the idea that there is another model out here. We can also change by insight. It is entirely possible, and this is what we're trying to see if we can do. Not trying, let me be stronger. I have changed my life through insight. Let me look at the data as it is. Let me understand why I might be resistant to what the data is telling me. Let me uncover those beliefs, see if they're serving me or not. If they aren't, eject them, and then change on my own terms. Because it's our belief that change is coming one way or the other. The question is, are we going to change on our own terms or some other terms? If those other terms happen to be nature's terms, well, that's going to be a rather abrupt, rather painful, and really, I think, to put a term on it, it'll be disappointing.
Yeah, I think that's an interesting point. The other thing which I found very interesting when we met in Madrid was you have the ability to drag out some pretty basic statistics, which we all know are there. But actually, we ignore. And one I remember very strongly was that I think you said that in something like the last 12 years, we have consumed half the oil that has ever been consumed. I mean, it was a figure like that. I probably got it wrong.
It's but close. It was 22 years.
22 years. Well, 10 years. What's 10 years in a century or two? and that I find interesting. It sort of brings us back to the sort of peak prosperity, because we're talking about maybe in a different way validating the arguments for peak oil rather than, you know, the sort of controversial thought, well, there's still lots of energy in the ground, it's just a question of price and so on and so forth. And the other thing that I found very interesting, and I'd like to pursue this line of thought, is that you pointed out something that I think we all know inside us, and that is that the human mind sort of thinks linearly, as it were, whereas an awful lot of what is happening is exponential, and that's very difficult to visualize. Now, we've seen, I think, certainly with oil, the demand has grown exponentially, if you like, over that last 22 years. I mean, to double in 22 years, having from all the previous, does imply an exponential growth. Mm-hmm. But now we're seeing the expansion of money becoming very much exponential, mm-hmm. arguably. It's been on an exponential path anyway, but it's become a lot more visibly so. Is this something that you expected? Is this something that you think is going to continue to maybe risk the point of destroying all money? Or how do you see this increase in the money supply? Is this something that is again exponential, that we can't visualize, that we're going to wake up to?
You know, I love widening out the lens, because there's a lot of noise and it's hard to understand and all the acronyms and it's very complicated and experts this and changing stories that. It's all very difficult, but it's not if we widen up a couple of f-stops, get our lens very wide. And it's this simple. You cannot have an exponential money system on a finite planet. You can for a while, but not forever. I am 100% convinced that sooner or later, the physical reality and of the world runs into and overtakes and swamps and wins against this exponential money system. It's an incredibly important point. It's not that there are other money systems out there that we can't use. There are. There's lots of other money systems that would comport with the physical reality, but we happen as an entire globe to have tied ourselves to a money system that has to continually expand, or it risks catastrophe. I mean, this is one way to understand it. I was talking with Steve Keen, the economist out of Australia, and I asked him to summarize. He's a very close Fed watcher. So I said, if you're looking at the central bank's behavior, what do you think their strategy is? And he said, panic.
Yes.
And I rather think that...
I think that's probably right. Yes.
I think it is. Yes. That they're trying like crazy to do something and they know not what, because they're over here in this... in isolation, looking at the economy, pulling all the usual levers that worked, and they've completely forgotten that those levers work and exist and have value if and only if all these other things are in place, these other things being the resources, food, fuel, water, bottom of Maslow's hierarchy of needs, like everything else builds off of those. And we're now running into limits on those, meaning we're not running out, just meaning we can't increase them by 3%, 4% a year. You know, this doubling you talked about to have consumed half of all the oil in 22 years means we've doubled oil consumption over the last 22 years. Well, what does that take to double it? Well, it turns out it takes about 2.5 to 3% to double something over 22 years. 2.5 to 3%, wait a minute, isn't that about how much we need our economy to grow for it to be at, you know, running at capacity or you know, hitting its trend line? And the answer is yes. Well, we can't do that forever. That's the story that's unwinding right now. And this story is a big one, right? So, you know, when we look back in 1,000 years, we're going to think it happened in the blink of an eye. When we're in the middle of it, it feels like it's taking forever to unfold. But in truth, things are changing at incredible speed. Anybody listening to this knows already that things are happening so fast you can't even process them at this point. Wait, what's happening in Libya? Uh-oh, is China and Japan, are they... getting, wait a minute, what's happening in Iran? Hold it, Spain. You know, it's just, it's never ending. So this, what's happening in detail is surprising to me as anybody, but the fact that things feel like they're colliding faster and faster and that the amplitude and frequency of the crises are starting to stack up, that's not surprising to me. This was a very easy prediction to make, looking at all the exponential trends that exist in the environment, in energy, in the economy, world financial world. So that's, you know, money creation, debt creation, fisheries loss, coal use, all these things, all exponentials, and here they are converging. And this is that's the context for where we are today.
That's an interesting point, because it's very difficult to know quite where we go from here when they converge. I mean, is this a sort of cosmic collision, as it were, the result of which we cannot imagine? Do you think that is where we're going, or is there a solution to this escalation of everything?
Well, there's no easy way to answer that, because I believe that solutions exist in certain places. Other areas, we're just facing predicaments, by which I mean there is no solution that will get them back to how they used to be. We now have to just manage the outcomes of these particular things. So, unless we get really Machiavellian, there's no solution to the idea that we have a demographic bulge in the developed worlds, which the pensions of which were built around this Ponzi scheme idea, where as long as there are more workers paying for fewer retirees, it was fine. And then we had this World War II thing, and then there was this baby boomer bulge, and now there's more people retiring than people behind them. That's just a predicament. We're going to have to manage that. The way in which our entitlement, Social Security, and pension systems were constructed as pyramids doesn't work when you don't have a pyramid. So unless we're willing to concede that we're going to just like axe retirees completely and not give them what they thought they were due, or we're going to really overburden the generation behind them to force them to pay for this, or, you know, that's a predicament. So as I sweep my gaze across the economy, energy, the environment, I truly see certain predicaments, particularly in the environment. Saudi Arabia sucking down its aquifers, which take 100,000 years to recharge, or however long it takes there. It's just ridiculous. Once they pump those aquifers dry, that water's gone. Then they're going to have to go to desalinization plants. They'll probably power it with oil, so their consumption with oil will go up, meaning they'll have less available for export, on and on, right? That's just a predicament at this point in time. So as I look out here, many of these predicaments are so ingrained, like the inertia, that they're just the trajectory, they're going to happen. There's nothing we can do about that except note that that's going to happen. And then we can control what we can around the edge of that to some extent. So that's really what we preach at our site, if we preach anything at all, is note what the risks are, note where the deficits might occur, and then control what you can and just leave the rest. Because there's nothing I can do. If the currency itself, like, there's nothing I can do to influence if my currency system is ultimately going to suffer a final catastrophe. I can, however, take some of my wealth. My currency still buys awesome things. The big brown truck of happiness will roll up my driveway after I click an internet order and give me awesome things, right? I can still buy gold. I can still buy silver. I can still improve my soils. I can insulate my house. My money has value. And so I would counsel, use that value while it still has value as a means of A, improving your quality of life, and B, controlling for this downside risk that someday there might be this currency crisis. Because the time you want to do that is way before it arrives.
Indeed. And this is very much, I think, the theme of everything that you're doing. And if I can ask you to be a little more specific, the current situation, we have the Fed is now buying up, I think it's $40 billion worth of mortgage debt every month, and it's continuing with Operation Twist, which basically, as I think quite simply, means that interest rates are going to be flat along the yield curve. They really must be, going back to the earlier comment, they really must be frightened, very, very frightened of something at the moment. Do you have any feeling what they are really frightened of?
I know what they're saying, and I don't believe it. So,
well, this is
the dual
point,
mandate.
Yes.
Let's take it at face value, because it reveals the absurdity. At face value, the Fed says we're going to buy mortgage-backed securities for as long as it takes for employment to recover. If you can articulate for me the mechanism by which buying a mortgage-backed security, which is currently sitting on a portfolio, say at AIG, is going to boost employment somewhere, I'm all ears. So if we, at face value, if the chain they're trying to follow is to say, well, because we buy mortgage-backed securities, we drive long-term interest rates down a little bit, we change risk preferences, which further makes, you know, a little bit more money available. So we're thinking mortgage rates will go down. And when mortgage rates go down, more people will be able to afford, so they'll start buying houses again. So maybe house prices will tick up, and then we'll need more houses again, so we'll hire construction workers. Good grief. Why doesn't the Fed just go out and just buy mortgages? Just wholesale, not the backed securities, buy the mortgage pools themselves and charge the people in the houses 0.25% like they're charging the banks. Just do it directly. Cut the middleman out.
Just nationalize them.
Yes. Yeah. They're already doing that de facto anyway, but by a very sort of circuitous route. Instead of giving the banks 0.25%, hoping the banks will take that 0.25% interest rate and go out and loan money then, why not just give the people the direct benefit, right? Which would directly impact households' expenditures, but that's not what they're doing. So instead, I can say that because the Fed is stepping into these markets in this with this awkward semantic gyrations, I don't trust that they're doing it for the reasons they're saying. Instead, there are guaranteed some of these mortgage-backed security pools are in desperate trouble right now. When you look at the delinquency rates across certain markets, it's horrible. There's 40% of all houses are underwater in Las Vegas, and the delinquency rate is in the high double-digit percentages. There are mortgage-backed securities wrapped up around that pool. I'll guarantee you that in their $40 billion a month, the Fed is plucking that one off of the market, the MBS that's wrapped up around a number of subdivisions in Las Vegas, or perhaps Phoenix, or perhaps Homestead, Florida, or any of these other places that are still in desperate times. So what the Fed is still trying to do is what they've always been trying to do, is rescue bank balance sheets. They want financial system health, yep, because I think they're worried about financial system
systemic risk.
Systemic risk. Yes. That's what they're trying to control.
So really, I think the point that you're making behind this is that it's a concern for collateral and trying to stop the Irving Fisher thing of collateral going down, banks calling in loans, again forcing collateral down, so on. They want to keep the collateral up. And certainly that has happened in the stock market here, I think, because despite the economic outlook, zero interest rates basically means that stocks have got to be attractive in an environment where bonds only yield 1 to 2%. So that's an interesting point, I think. How long do you think the Fed can keep interest rates? Because they're sitting on interest rates, they're keeping them low. And I know the Taylor rule might say that, well, you know, they should be minus this and so on and so forth. But assuming we don't buy into that argument, how long do you think the Fed can keep interest rates this low? And when they rise, won't that produce a huge, great crisis of government finances?
Well, the lesson from Japan is they can keep them low for a very long time.
But with Japan, there's a difference in the sense that the ownership of the yen and JGBs is very much the Japanese people. But here we're talking about the international currency, which everybody accounts in and therefore everybody owns, and they own the debt, the government debt and all the rest of it. So it's a wider thing than the Japanese thing.
Right, so the core question then is how much longer will foreigners continue to buy U.S. debt? Right, so unless the Fed wants to become the entire market for U.S. Treasuries, which they might,
they're going that way.
They were 60-70% of it last year.
Yes,
that being 2011. So we'll see what happens this year. The thing that concerns me, that makes me think this could stretch out longer and longer, is that we see this coordinated intervention now: ECB, Bank of Japan, Bank of England soon, I bet, and the Fed, and. One of the prime duties of any of the central banks is to assure that the sovereign entities themselves manage to keep getting funded. I mean, that's the cartel quid pro quo, right? We'll grant you your operating license, but please don't let us ever go bankrupt because we might crankily revoke that or something. I don't, you know, whatever that central bank to government sort of role is, I truly believe that keeping the sovereign bond markets growing and well supplied with liquidity is absolutely one of the functions of the central banks. What concerns me is that with this coordinated intervention, there's no reason now that I can think of that the Federal Reserve wouldn't find a way. And it's got this extraordinarily huge other assets bucket that we can't look into because we can't audit it, right? It's a couple hundred billion. That the central banks just supply the liquidity for each other now, right?
Indeed.
So if Europe needs funding and U.S. is supplying that funding and then the U.S. needs funding and Europe's supplying that funding, that sort of double handholding can go on for a very long time. There has to be some sort of a structured market revolt that becomes larger than the central bank's ability to intervene. And the difficulty I have in understanding how that could mathematically happen is there's no limit to the number of zeros you can park on the end of something with a computer.
Do you think that rising food prices and things like that might upset this apple cart?
So the sources of pressure that I'm tracking that I think are very interesting in this is what's happening in Asia right now. So China's got $3.2 trillion in foreign reserves at this point in time. A lot of those, most of them, euros and dollars at this stage. They're very sensitive to rising food prices over there. And of course, with the droughts this year, we have a structural reason for rising food prices. But a tailwind to that even is the amount of liquidity dumped into the markets, right? You can't just create $40 billion a month and trust it's all going to go to stocks, right? A lot of that's going to leak out into commodities, is history's lesson. So as food prices rise in China, they're going to need to do one of two things. They're going to, well, probably the only thing they could really do is allow the yuan to rise. So if they do that, all of a sudden, now they don't have a very compelling reason to hold U.S. treasuries or to buy more of them, because they're actually going to be losing money on those relatively quickly.
So that's a very interesting prospect. I think we ought to leave it there. It's been very interesting. How can our listeners find you?
At peakprosperity.com, and they could Google Chris Martenson, Martenson. Rises obviously right to the top of the list. And the Crash Course is both an online video series, which has 20 chapters if you want the whole thing. The Madrid conference you mentioned before, we've got that captured as well. That's a 45-minute presentation, very nicely shot. I thought they did a good job with that. And there's a book, The Crash Course, which is available anywhere.
And I have read the book, and I can confirm that it is actually a very important book to read. Chris, thank you very much indeed.
Alistair, my pleasure.
Subscribe to the Gold Money newsletter at www.goldmoney.com to receive email updates on new articles, videos, and iTunes podcasts from our Gold Research section.